Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. It's really a pleasure to be here again. I think this is my fourth time in Trieste, each time for a conference on dynamical systems. So what I will speak about concerns joint works with mostly with Derwan and Klepsin. There are also some works with Derwan, Klepsin, and Filimonov. And there is this soccer team with Alvarez, Filimonov, Klepsin, Malise, Menino, and Michele Triestino. And this concerns some questions arising from the community of codimension one foliations. But let me start with something very classical and elementary that appears in all books on dynamical systems, which is the most basic tool in one-dimensional dynamics, which is control of distortion. So for me, I will, for this talk, I will only consider control of distortion for maps without singularities because I will deal with diffeomorphisms. And by this, I mean, well, you take a map from a one-dimensional manifold from to itself, and you try to get a bound of the derivatives of the iterates of this map, and you try to compare these derivatives for two different points, and you try to get some uniform bound for this quotient here, which is independent on the number of iterates. And everybody knows that if you get something like this, then you should get a theorem, because this gives you a kind of control of the geometry when passing from one scale to another. So in general, when you pass from a small scale to another one. So this is the general principle. If you get something like this, then you should get some theorem. So in my case, since I will deal with foliations and group actions, I will not only consider a single diffeomorphism, but I will consider finitely many diffeomorphisms, and I will do compositions instead of iteration of a single diffeomorphism. So in my case, I will consider, instead of the nth iterate of F, I will consider a map like Fn, which is going to be the composition of certain maps, Gin, Gin minus 1, and so on, where this Gij, these maps here, belong to a finite family of diffeomorphisms. Okay, so what is important here is to have a finite family, say, of generators of your dynamics. Okay, and again, instead of getting something like this, the idea will be to get a control of distortion for the nth composition of these maps. Not for every kind of composition, but for certain compositions that allows to say something about the dynamics. Okay? And just to complete this discussion, let me just remind you the most famous and the simplest argument in this direction, which is due to Danjoua, but it was pursued by some other people. So Danjoua did it for the case of a single diffeomorphism. Schwarz realized that it worked for any, it works in a different manner, but it was Saxeder that introduced this technique in the world of foliations. And it says something which is very easy to state. So it says that if you take two points living in interval I, which is wandering, let me change it. Living in some interval J, which is wandering for the dynamics, which means that the image of the along the compositions are 2 by 2 disjoint. So you take J, then in this setting you take the first image of J, the second image, or the image up to the second level, and so on. So these are 2 by 2 disjoint. Then you get control of distortion, okay? Provided that you impose some regularity on the generators, and the regularity is that they are all C2 diffeomorphisms. or at least C2 local diffeomorphism. Actually, C1 plus bounded variation is enough, but anyway. So then in this case, you get this uniform bound for the distortion, and the constant is very explicit. So this is less or equal than L times C, where L is the length of your manifold, of your one-dimensional manifold I, and C is the Lipschitz constant for the derivative of the generator. So is the maximal Lipschitz constant for the derivative of the generators. Okay? And I think everybody knows the argument, so you just take the logarithm of this and then you do the computation, and I think everybody knows, okay? The important point here is that since the intervals are 2 by 2 disjoint, and this sum is and the logarithm of this is controlled by the total sum of the length of the intervals, and since they are disjoint, then this total sum is bounded by the length of the manifold. Okay, this is the Danjoua-Schwarz-Sachsenhardt estimate. And there is another estimate that in general it's also attributed to Danjoua, but I think this is wrong because Danjoua didn't think about this. Is in the case where you don't have this property, but you know that the dynamics is somehow contracting in a hyperbolic way. So this is the hyperbolic case in some sense. This is referred to as being the folklore argument in the book of Pallis and Takens. So I don't know who really stated for the first time, but the idea is that if you take 2 points and if you know that the derivatives are larger or equal than certain constant which is larger than one, then again you get control of distortion. And in this case, you get this control of distortion for points that remain at a bounded distance along the direction. Okay? And the idea is that, well, here you have the total sum of the lengths is finite because the intervals are disjoint, and here the total sum of the lengths is finite because when you take the dynamics in the inverse sense, then the length of the interval is decreasing in an exponential way. So the total sum is controlled by a geometric series, so it is finite. Okay? And with this very simple tool and some arguments in each case, one can prove the classical theorems in this setting. So the first is Danjoua theorem, which says that, if you take a As I said before, this control of distortion is still work for C1 plus bounded variation diffeomorphisms. So if you take a C1 plus bounded variation diffeomorphism with irrational rotation number, C1 plus bounded variation diffeomorphism of the circle, then the theorem says that F is minimal. Okay? So there is no invariant Cantor set for the dynamics. So it is minimal, and actually, because of Poincaré theorem, says that because of Poincaré theorem, it is conjugate, topologically conjugate to the rotation. And there is also the Jean-Christophe version of this theorem for F, which is a homeomorphism of the circle, of course, with irrational rotation number, but which is real analytic, which is somehow different because here you allow many critical points, but since you are real analytic, you only have finitely many of those, and they are non-degenerate, and then there is some extra argument here. And of course, this applies. This version of the control of distortion applies to this situation, because if you have a diffeomorphism which is not minimal, then there is an invariant Cantor set, and then you take the gap of the invariant Cantor set, so which means the connected component of a connected component of the complement of the Cantor set, and then you start iterating your diffeomorphism, and this gap is a Wander interval for the dynamics, so you get control of distortion. And at the end, there is an extra argument in order to get a contradiction. There is always an extra argument to get a contradiction. But the point is that the main tool is there in the control of distortion technique. Pardon? Sorry?
The conclusion is the same.
F is minimal. Sorry. OK? So, well, here there is a very big difference. This is from 32, and this is from, sorry, 83. OK. OK. And there is another, well, here you know that the diffeomorphism is minimal, so the next question is to ask whether it is ergodic with respect to the natural measure, which is the Lebesgue measure in this case. And this is also a theorem which was independently proved by Michel Herman and Katok. So again, if you take a C1 plus bounded variation diffeomorphism with irrational rotation number, then, well, according to Najrath theorem, it is minimal, but this theorem that says that F is ergodic with respect to the Lebesgue measure, okay? Which is not at all a trivial stuff, because you know, there is an invariant measure for diffeomorphism, but in general, the invariant measure of the diffeomorphism is singular with respect to the Lebesgue measure. So this is not obvious at all. And again, for this theorem, there is both the proofs are very different. So, but the proof of by Katok uses this principle in a very tricky way, and it uses the fact that if you look at the dynamical decomposition, which means that, well, you take a point and then you take the nth interval of the dynamical composition, which means that you take the image of this point by the iterate to the corresponding to the power qn, where qn is the denominator in the rational approximation of the rotation number, then this interval here, which I will denote by jn, well, it is not wandering for the dynamics, but it is almost wandering up to certain time, so that the whole circle is covered by the iterators of this interval, and the multiplicity of the covering is bounded. Actually, it's bounded by 2. So this allows to, although these intervals are not disjoint, they are almost disjoint in a certain sense. So you can still apply you still get the control of distortion, and having control of distortion, you can prove something, and in this case, this is the ergodicity of the action. And, well, this is for the case of a single diffeomorphism. But for the case we are interested now, we have certain results, especially in the somehow in the hyperbolic case. So there is another theorem that I will just state. I will not recall all the words here, but well, the theorem says that if you take a C1 plus alpha dynamically defined Cantor set. Well, the Lebesgue measure of this Cantor set is equal to zero, and actually the Hausdorff dimension is smaller than one. Okay, which this means more or less that this Cantor set is given by a Markov partition. Okay, and there is another theorem that I think it goes back to Sullivan, but it's not clear. Maybe it was already known. Is that, well, if you take, a group gamma acting on a pseudo group acting on a one-dimensional manifold by C1 plus alpha local diffeomorphisms, and if you assume that it is hyperbolic in the sense that, for instance, for every x in the manifold, there exists some element for which the derivative at this point is larger than one, then the action is ergodic. Well, this in the case of minimality. So if you have a minimal action which is expanding, which means that for every point there is an expanding element, then the action is ergodic. And this uses this principle here, again, control of distortion going from a small scale to a large one, and so on. So there is also a version for the case where there are invariant Cantor sets. In that case, well, what you have is that if every point of the Cantor set is expanded by a group element, then the Lebesgue measure of the Cantor set is zero. Okay? And motivated by this kind of results, there were some conjectures. Well, by many people, so I will write some names here, but actually I should say that the first time I learned about this condition was reading the book of De Mello and Weinstein, which says the following. So I will state this conjecture in the world of codimension one foliation. So assume that you have a codimension one foliation. On a compact manifold. So a codimension one foliation can be seen as a dynamical object where the dynamics is given by the holonomy maps. Okay, this is the issue here. Naturally, if you want to do something like this, you have to impose some regularity condition, is that this foliation is of class C2 transversely, okay? Because the dynamics is given by the holonomies along transversals. And well, the conjectures are the following. If F is minimal, which means that if the only saturated closed sets are the empty set and the whole manifold, then F is ergodic, again, with respect to the Lebesgue measure, which means that the only measurable saturated sets are those of zero measure of total measure. And if there is a what is called an exceptional leaf, which is a saturated set, such that transversally looks as a Cantor set. So I will state in this way. If there is a transversal Cantor set, then the Lebesgue measure of this Cantor set should be equal to zero. And the gaps should be finitely many up to the equivalence relation given by the dynamics. Okay, and so let me just say that More or less, the transversal minus the Cantor set is made up of finitely many orbits. Okay. And well, these are still open, but what we did with the Rank-Clebsin and the Rank-Clebsin and Filimonov was to deal with this question in the simplest case. I mean, in the not in the simplest case. I mean, in the case where the foliation is given by a suspension of a group action. Okay, so let me remind you that if you have a group action, for I will consider group actions on the circle. So I will take a group gamma acting on the circle, say finitely generated. Essentially, the condition here corresponds to the condition here that the manifold is compact. And when you have this, then you can produce a foliation on a three manifold by the suspension procedure. So you take a very, for instance, you take a very big a surface with a very big large genus. You map this into a free group of a large number of generators, so that this maps into gamma, and then you get some group of homomorphism here, and then you take the Poincaré disk time S1, then you get an action on this product space where a map G, say gamma here, maps Px into gamma P, phi of gamma x, where this is the deck transformation and this is the action provided by this composition here. And delta is the, okay, this is the unit disk, the hyperbolic disk. Okay, so I am looking at this as the covering of the surface, okay? And then you quotient by this action, and the quotient is a foliation on SG times the circle. Okay, the quotient is this a co-dimension one foliation on the surface times the circle that retains all the dynamics of the group action. Okay. What?
Why did you get this
surface?
I mean, you
get the portion. Maybe. Yeah. Okay. So, by this I mean that I take gamma is generated by k elements, so I consider these elements as free elements. And here I take the G equals to 2K, so I take the K element that maps into the generator, and the other one I send to the identity. And in this way, I get exactly what I say. Okay. Okay, what is important is that if you take a group action, then you produce a foliation. So if you want to prove something for foliations in this world, the first thing you should try to do is proving something for group actions. Okay, and so the conjectures or become a conjecture question about group actions. So take a gamma acting on the circle by gamma finitely generated and gamma acting by C2 diffeomorphisms. And the question is twofold, or actually threefold. So in the minimal case, the question is, if the action is minimal, whether it is ergodic with respect to the Lebesgue measure. And the second thing is, if there exists a Cantor set, an invariant Cantor set. Actually, here, this case is easier to stay, because if there is an invariant Cantor set, then this Cantor set turns to be unique. So say K, then the Lebesgue measure should be equal to 0. And the circle and the number of connected components of the complement should be finite up to so it should be it should consist of finitely many orbits. Okay, this is somehow Gies and Sullivan, and this is Hector's conjecture. So let me just say that, for instance, for the case of Fuchsian groups acting on the circle, this is not obvious. This is a theorem. This is a theorem by Alfors, which actually also holds in dimension 2. So it works for Fuchsian groups and Kleinian groups. This is called the Alfors finiteness theorem. Okay, let me just give an example, a very simple example of what should we have in mind in this setting. So take the circle and take two maps. You can take them inside Pessel to R. Say F, by this I mean that F maps the complement of this interval into the interior of this interval, okay? And then take G doing this. This is the ping pong dynamic. So G is taking the complement of this interval into the interior of this interval. When you have this, then you immediately get a Cantor set, which is invariant for the dynamics. This is the simplest way to create a Cantor set for a dynamics of a group action on the circle. And well, in this case, it is not very hard to see that if F and G are C2, then the Cantor set has zero Lebesgue measure. Okay? But this is the example that you should keep in mind, because somehow what I will show is that this is, at least in the reality case, this is more or less the only example that can arise. Okay? So the theorem is that, well, this is a theorem, a genuine theorem in this setting. So I will impose the condition that the generators are real analytic. Otherwise, there are some technical problems for the proof. We still don't know that whether this is true. And of course, always finitely generated. And well, the first thing is that if there exists a Cantor set, then we managed to prove that the Lebesgue measure of the Cantor set is 0, and the Hector conjecture, which is that the complement is made up by finitely many orbits. And the second thing is that if the action is minimal, and well, here we need an extra hypothesis, which is algebraic, and gamma is almost free, so it is a free group up to a finite index subgroup. Actually, we can remove this hypothesis by asking for gamma to have infinitely many ends, but anyway. Then the action is ergodic with respect to the Lebesgue measure. So these are the solution of this conjecture for the case of group actions, provided that the action is by real analytic diffeomorphisms, and with this extra hypothesis on the group for the second case, which is actually, it is also needed in the first for this result. But what happens here is that it was already known that if you have an invariant Cantor set and you are really analytic, then the group must be almost free. This was a previous result by Gies. Okay? Okay. And so I still have 15 minutes, so I will say a few ideas about the proof. The proof is very technical. You can imagine this. So we use the classical control of distortion stuff, but the point is that we don't try to solve this question directly. What we prove is a kind of structure theorem for the action that gives us this information in an indirect way, okay? This was a strategy suggested by Colon. And somehow what we are doing is that in the most difficult cases, we are proving that there is a certain Markov structure for the dynamics from which everything arises naturally. Okay? So let me introduce a notion that we called with Bertrand and Victor property star, which is a very bad name, but anyway, it remained. So property star is the following. So remember that there was this Sullivan expansion strategy that uses hyperbolic control of distortion that says that if for every point there is an expanded element, then you get everything, you get control of distortion, and so on. So the problem is when there are points that are not expandable, okay? So property star means that if X is non-expandable, which means that for every group element, the derivative at this point is smaller or equal than 1, then there exists some group element which fixes this point, and for which this point is an isolated fixed point. Okay, actually we need this point to be isolated from one side, but since we are really analytic, we have automatically this property. Okay, and the example to to have in mind here, so this is, well, this condition is asked for every point in the minimal case, and in the case where there is a Cantor set, it's asked only for points in the Cantor set, okay? And the example to keep in mind here is the same example as here in the limit case, when this circle is becoming larger and larger, and this one is becoming larger and larger, and they have a common boundary point, okay? So something like this. So this is F, and this is G. Okay, this is a free group, and this can be modeled out in Bessel to R, and in this case, this point becomes non-expandable points. And this is not unnatural at all. So I mean, this is not artificial because this appear as a finite index subgroup in in Bessel to R. So this group, the group generated by these two elements is a free subgroup. It's a free group. And this can be realized as inside PSL2Z as an index 6 subgroup, I think. Actually, if you take PSL2Z, then there are two points that are non-expandable. This is an easy computation, the origin and the infinite. These are the only points for which there is no matrix in this group, which for which the derivative is larger than 1. So this is an example of an action with non-expandable point, but what is quite visible here is that these non-expandable points are fixed points of certain elements. For instance, here I think if you take the commutator of F and G, then this is going to fix one of these points, that it is not going to be the identity. Here it is easier to see that 0 and infinite are fixed points of certain similarities, I think. So property star holds in this case. So there are two things. Now there are two issues. The first thing is that if property star holds, then everything holds. I mean, then you get ergodicity in the minimal case, and then you get zero Lebesgue measure for Cantor set, and you get finitely many orbits, of connected components, of the complement of the Cantor sets, and so on. So we are happy in this case. Okay? Okay? And the second thing is, and this is the difficult theorem, is that property start always holds. So this is okay in the C2 category, and this we can prove under this hypothesis. So in the real analytic context and with this extra algebraic hypothesis for the minimal case. Okay? But we suspect that this is always true, but maybe not, but I think at least the conjecture should be true in general. Okay? So let me explain point one, which is not very hard, at least to for explaining the idea, because the idea is just a mixture of the classical techniques of control of distortion. Because, well, the first thing is that, well, if you think a little bit, if there are non-expandable points, and say we have a minimal action, then the number of non-expandable points has to be finite. This is not very hard to see. So you have only finitely many non-expandable points. So these are the bad points. So you put a flag here because these are the dangerous regions. And outside these regions, in these intervals, we have expanding elements, because these are these are the only non-expandable points. So here you can perform the hyperbolic trick, the hyperbolic expansion. Okay? But the point is that if you are very close to these points, then you lose expansion, because the derivative become closer and closer to one. But because of the definition of the hypothesis, these points here are also fixed points of some elements. So for instance, this point here is the fixed point of a certain group element F, an isolated fixed point. And so if you take, say, assume that F has no fixed point in this interval and moves x to the left in this case, so this is F of x, and you take this interval, this is going to be a fundamental region for the iteration of F. So the image of this interval are going to be disjoint, and you do it in the other way around, and what you get is control of distortion using the Danjoua strategy. The total sum of the length of the interval is finite, independently where you are. You can be very close to this point, but it doesn't matter. You use a very large number of iterations of F inverse, and you escape from this bad region. And when you're outside this bad region, you continue doing the hyperbolic trick and so on. You keep control of distortion, and you are happy. Okay? This is just the idea. The rest is just trying to put things together in an appropriate way. Okay, and so the difficult point, the real theorem, the genuine theorem here is this one. So that property start is always true under our hypothesis. And as I said before, what we do to prove this is to prove a certain structure theorem that actually should be one should be able to pursue this thing. So I will state a conjecture in order to explain what we have in mind here. So if you take a gamma, which is real analytic, finitely generated, and say locally discrete. Otherwise, everything is too simple, because if your group is not locally discrete, well, ergodicity is for free because you have flows in the closures and so on. Then the conjecture is that there exists a Markov partition for the dynamics. I mean, in the this should be true in the minimal case. For the case of a Cantor set, there should be a Markov partition of the Cantor set for the dynamics. And if the action is minimal and expanding, then gamma should be a surface group. I think this is the more interesting statement of this conjecture. So gamma should be a surface group up to finite index, I mean, or up to a finite extension, maybe. OK, this is. Locally discrete is that Let me give the precise definition. For every open interval, if Fn, which are group elements restricted to G, converge to the identity, actually we need C1 locally discrete, then eventually Fn is the identity for n very large. Okay? And I think this is the point, is that under our hypothesis, actually there should be some very, very deep results on the structure of the action. So let me just give the single idea of the proof of the somehow where you will see that there is a kind of Markov partition that arises in this stuff. Okay, well, this is very clear in this picture. So here there is a Markov partition. And the point is how to detect this Markov partition. Well, this only uses control of distortion. So somehow the points on these intervals are characterized in terms of sums of derivatives. And sums of derivatives are the genuine tools to get control of distortion. So what I showed at the very beginning, that you need total sum of length of the intervals to get control of distortion, is not totally true in the sense that the real thing that you need is that the total sum of the sum of the derivatives to be finite. And this is implied by the fact that the total sum of the length of the interval is finite. So let me just say that. So for instance, this is a free group. And now I will define a set in this case. So M gamma, for a gamma, a generator of this group, so gamma is going to be F inverse G or G inverse. M gamma is going to be the set of points on the circle such that the sum of geodesics, sum of the derivatives along geodesics that start with gamma is finite. Okay, so you look at iteration of along geodesic for which the first step is equal to gamma. This is going to give you a set, and this in this case it is not very hard to recognize that this set, for instance, for G, this is M of G. And then you define M tilde of gamma as being the intersection of M delta, where delta is different from gamma inverse. Okay? And in this setting, this is going to be the set M tilde G. And these sets here, when the group is free, where if the group is free, well, this is the case here, but if the group is free, there is a well-defined notion of geodesic and so on, so it's easier to handle. And these sets are going to provide the Markov partitions. But to prove this, well, there are some technicalities. I will just say something. So The first step in proving this is something which is not obvious, is that these sets are open. But this is control of distortion. Okay, these sets are open. But what is not obvious is that these sets are made up of finitely many connected components. But the most important step is that the endpoints of these sets, of the connected components of these sets, are fixed points for some group elements. Okay? And it is at that step that there is a key argument that, well, after we did it, I noticed that somehow it reminds the proof of Magnier of his characterization of hyperbolicity for attractors in one-dimensional dynamics. Somehow, because you impose some condition on the derivatives, so there is no hyperbolicity, and then you get that this point must be fixed by a certain element. So there is something that reminds me is reminiscent of Magnier's argument of his proof of the characterization of hyperbolicity of invariant measures. So this is the key step. So this family of sets is going to provide a Cantor, a Markov partition, for which the endpoints are fixed points for some group elements, and then everything works. Perfect. Okay, so I think I should stop. Thank you very much.